So maybe I can give a very brief introduction to our speaker. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce Rita. She's been working in many fields of protein biophysics using both theoretical and experimental methods, both in the United States and Europe, before returning to Italy, where she's been appointed full professor of biochemistry and biophysics at the University of Bologna. She's leading the biocomputing unit at the Bologna University since 1995. And the group has since been active in several fields of bioinformatics and computational biology, developing computer modeling for the study of several problems and systems in biology, such as protein folding, protein-protein, protein-nucleic acids interactions, as well as the prediction of subcellular localization of proteins with specific focus on membrane proteins, and more in general for the annotation of genomes and using methods from machine learning and deep neural networks. More recently, the group has been active in different international benchmarking efforts to assess the performance of their tools for the annotation of disease-associated variants, like in the CAGI, critical assessment of genome annotation, and CAFA, critical assessment of function annotation, where the results of the group distinguished among the top performing methods in both cases. Rita has been promoter, co-founder, and coordinator of the International Bologna Master in Bioinformatics, and has been involved in several PhD programs, all related to computational biology and bioinformatics. And she tutored more than 40 graduate and undergraduate students through the years. And she's now a faculty member of the PhD program in data science and computation. She's been appointed a member of national and international panels for the evaluation of research grants and fellowships, including the ERC, where she's member of the evaluation panel in life science. And she's also appointed editor for the Journal of Molecular Biology and Nucleic Acid Research, Bioinformatics and Genomics. I think I would rather stop here, otherwise the list is really long, but I think we are really looking forward to hear your seminar, Rita. Thank you very much for joining us, and please.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation, for the very the too long introduction. And in principle, I'd rather be in Barcelona, but we know that I couldn't come, okay? For several reasons, including this terrible pandemic. Well, the reason why I picked up this particular theme that I realized going back through what the biocomputing group did through the years, is that this has been one of the leitmotif of our research. So I will try to focus on this problem of protein-protein interactions that I think is multidimensional, and you will see my view of this particular problem in the context also of a biophysical approach. And later on, you will see the latest development in our group and what we can do with the latest development. Having said this, I will start immediately. And I don't have to tell you, but I will start immediately with all the ingredients of the biological complexity at the cell level. And as we know, nowadays we are capable of defining different layers in this complexity and collecting data with different approaches at the different layer of complexities. And later on, for each layer of complexity, we have data, different metrics, and the possibility of generating different tools for data analysis. So you can immediately focus the principal problem here, that is that later on you have different approaches that you pretend to link in order to have a general model for whatever complexity is the cell. In principle, nowadays, you know, after so much genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, etc., etc., we are also interested in what is the macromolecular crowding. So, how practically all the molecules in the cell environment interact, and interacting affects the physiology of the cell and how the cell are working and obviously performing the process that we call life. So there are several items here that I will not be able to expand as I wished, but the idea is that nowadays there is this tendency of considering also a phenomenon that is called liquid phase condensation. Liquid phase condensation, that is just at the beginning in terms of its characterization, perhaps is the key towards a link, a possible link between what is going on and what we know at the specific molecular level and what is happening in the context of the cell in order to support the physiology of the cell. So it's even the link that will allow us to consider into the figure, into the model, whatever is dynamics in the cell interior, because we know that when we are saying even protein-protein interaction, although we have a static view of the phenomenon, we have also to think in terms of what's going on in the different time course or whatever we are following. So in principle, since a couple of years, I would say that this story of the liquid phase condensation is really interesting and worth, obviously, of very many experiments that are ongoing, but they are still at the beginning. Having said this, so perhaps we have a new possibility of linking whatever is going on at the level of the different molecules and at the level of a large scale organization of the molecule, including their interaction. I would rather enter into the detail again of what is really the protein phase separation. The protein phase separation, it's practically drawn, it's practically explained in this very simplistic view, in which you have practically a sort of homogeneous environment, in which once in a while, depending on signals, depending on the cell needs, specific proteins will get together in order to perform biological processes. And this is really fascinating. But again, we don't have enough data to enter into this specific modeling. So in principle, what we know so far is that there are practically membraneless organelles that are common to several types of cell working under physiological condition. And some of these organelles have been noticed since, I would say, 100 years, such as the Cajal body. I will come back to this particular view, and I will tell you something really interesting that we are going through these days. Okay, so you know that before entering into the problem of macromolecular crowding and how proteins interacts or the protein interacts with nucleic acids, we have to know also all the details of the human proteomes, because before doing the interactomes, we are also responsible of doing interactomes when on specific and detailed human proteomes. So I just mentioned two initiatives of the many that are around, the most important one, that are the Protein Atlas and the Human Proteomic Proteome Project. In case you need details, you have here all the web server that tell you whatever is going on and how to update your knowledge in this field. So basically, when we think what we know in terms of the interactome, we know that first of all, we have to know the proteome, and then we may go through the interactome with two main techniques, such as the yeast-to-hybrid system and the affinity purification approach plus mass spectroscopy. I just mentioned these two major techniques because the most recent publications or the most recent releases of the interactomes are based on these two specific approaches. So basically, when you are saying interactome, you may, you know, simplify saying that it plays a major role in generating the complexity of cellular processes. If perturbed, the interactome can lead to the impairment of biological function and then to diseases, and is crucial also in the host-pathogen communication. Here you have obviously a picture, a representation of the interactome. I mentioned the staticity of this representation because obviously you are projected, as soon as you have collected the data, you represent them and you are projected in a sort of virtual space that is stable through whatever you are you know, considering and whatever you want later on to zoom in order to get details. So this is the typical networking or network representation of the interactome that obviously stands on the graph theory, as everybody knows, I suspect. Very good. How can I go on here? So first of all, sampling the human interactomic space, it requires many efforts. And I just collected here a few historical publication in which the two techniques were applied in order to get hints, to get information on the human interactomes. And particularly, I like this paper that was the first one out of Matthias Mann group, trying also to point out the necessity of following even the change in concentration of the different proteins when you are thinking in terms of an interactome. So different resources, and obviously when you are dealing with these virtual spaces, what you are asking to yourself is always, but do these data compare to each other? Yes, no. By now we have different human interactomes available. So what we did recently, I'm not able to get rid of this Rita Casadio that perhaps is in the middle. What we did recently was to focus, since we had to write a review article, we focused on two particular updated interactomes that are respectively called URI and BioPlex. And this URI is based on affinity plus mass spectroscopy. No, affinity purification and mass spectroscopy is BioPlex. And URI is based on the yeast-to hybrid system. They can be retrieved at these websites, and they do belong to very important organization. So these last releases, in principle, having as reference human, as a reference human genome, the release number 38 of the genome, they consider practically to investigate a rather equal number of proteins with a similar number of interactions. So what is interesting here? It's interesting here to understand that when we compare the results of these two released human interactomes, we found that the number of shared proteins among the interactomes is in the range of 50% of the number of proteins they started with. The number of interaction among shared proteins is in the range of 30%. But when you are going down and kneeling the number of shared interaction, this is really, really small. And it tantamounts to some 1,000 proteins with shared interactions. Sorry, but I have to be very like this. Okay, so as you might understand yourself, here we are in front of the usual situation. Huge volume of data. When you try to compare this data, in principle, in spite of addressing the very same problem, although with different techniques and methods, in principle, they are leading towards different interactomic spaces. Having said this, I'm going simply to comment on the fact that there are still several open issues in the interactomic space that are data quality and reproducibility, coverage of the proteome, tissue specificity, subcellular localization, and co-expression. Quite sure that everybody involved in this specific field is now producing other data, and we will can see in a year what's going on of extremely new. Very good. So, problem, and here comes the multidimensionality. So we explored one space, the interactomic space, and now we are asking to ourselves if we have another level of description, which perhaps contains more details, and it's obviously here the situation in which we are going from the systemic scale, the interactome as such, to the atomic scale, the specific edges in the network that eventually contain atomic contain information with atomic resolution. So this is what I want to point out with this slide and with the question, to which extent do we know the property of the different nodes or edges? So as you see here in the left column, you see a reference to INTERC, that is one of the more curated databases as to the interactomic space. And then you have one of the many different interactome three-dimensional assembly that we derived from the PDB. Having said this, why it's important to have structural information? Because first of all, you can predict the protein interaction sites, as we will discuss in a moment. And this will be done by starting from monomeric structure, or it can be done starting from monomer sequences. And we will see the difference. And to know interaction sites is important because later on you may characterize even so functionally annotate the protein structure and then discover novel interaction patches or even improve docking methods if necessary. Nowadays we have enough statistics that we can consider when we are addressing the problem of knowing with atomic resolution what is a protein complex. And recent statistics in our group points out to the fact that nowadays we have some 67,000 complexes in the PDB, so about one third of the PDB is in a sort of complex situation in relation to the deposit. And we can simply simplify this situation saying that we have homomers or heteromers. Obviously, there is a difference in the number of these, but you know, you may play around with a lot of interaction surfaces. Again, taxonomy, every possible kingdom or every possible taxa is characterized by complexes known with atomic resolution, and the biological process that is mostly represented is the metabolic process. Okay? So again, statistics that you may think of some interest for you. So immediately when you have, when you know the situation and you define a specific database solved with atomic resolution, you may end up saying, what is then the interaction surface As all you need a definition, and as you may appreciate from this cartoon, the definition is that set of any residues showing a difference in the accessible surface area between the monomer and the complex. So if you have a complex, you have to divide the complex into two monomers, or you may be even so keen to select only those complexes that have also the monomers that have been crystallized independently. And you may realize that there is a difference in the accessible solvent area of each residue when you go from the monomer to the complex. So this is more or less the more natural, I would say, definition of what is an interaction surface that is around in many papers, including ours. And when you have these interfaces or these contact surfaces, well, then you may start studying all the biophysical properties of the residues in the contact surfaces. The most trivial one, but also the most natural one, is the composition. And you hope to have a difference in the composition of the surfaces that are accessible when they are then later on at the interface, or the surfaces that are never at the interface. But the problem is, as you may appreciate from this data, whatever they are, that you have all the different residues classified in terms of their chemical physical properties, polar, polar charge, and the frequency at the in the interacting patches in red versus whatever is observed at the surface of the protein interacting with the solvent. And so you see, you may derive, or you may conclude yourself that yes, there are some differences somehow, but there is not obviously the possibility to start from the observation of the composition of the surfaces to implement what we call a computational tool that is later on reliable. So textbook can help us, because protein-protein interaction is a biophysical complex phenomenon that is governed by shape, chemical complementarity, flexibility, residue-specific composition, less charge, more hydrophobic than in the solvent accessible surface of the protein, perhaps. And then later on, that hydrophobic interaction, weak electrostatic interaction, so to say the van der Waals interaction, are responsible of the stability of the complexes. And so I don't have the time, neither the willing, of going through all the different methods that were developed through the years in order to investigate the property of the surfaces in interaction in proteins. But the problem is, again, that you may focus on so many different features: residue propensity, physicochemical properties, residue conservation, curvature, depth and protrusion indexes, solvent exposure, secondary structure, B factor, electrostatic potential, energy solvation, etc. And then for each of these features, practically, we have the complementary methods or methods that were developed through the years. But in principle, whoever tried to describe and to discriminate between interaction surfaces and non-interaction surfaces concluded that there are no major emerging features. And in principle, the information basically is a sort of complex combination of all the different features. A classical situation in which then later on you may enter into the approach of considering that, after all, artificial intelligence based method may help. In principle, if you go through whatever has been developed through the years, you find, for example, here I was sort of selecting a sample of implemented methods in which you have the categories, so to say, what do they take in input and what they've been implementing. So based on means so many different methods, you know, that are around since a while. Some of them survived, such as, for example, the spider, and some other, they are sort of being still available, but everybody, they are not popular any longer. But in any case, I hope that I gave you the idea of the complexity of this task, specific task. So to sum up, nowadays, basically around, we have methods available as web servers that are template-based or machine learning-based. So the template-based methods, do they exploit sequence or structural similarity to transfer interaction sites from known structural templates? Basically, they have a very nice accuracy. They require templates for the interacting complex, because otherwise you are completely lost. Machine learning-based approach are more general. You may start from sequence, and so you have all the categories, the category of all the methods that are sequence-based predictor. They extract information from monomer sequence. They have a broad applicability, and basically they are characterized by low accuracy. And then you have the structure-based predictors that are more accurate generally than sequence-based method. They are obviously taking as input information from both the sequence and the structure of the different monomer, and they require a structural model of the monomer. So, as everybody perhaps in the world knows by now, what is machine learning? Machine learning requires a good training phase in which you have all the features that are derived from the structure sequence, and you couple all these features to the known examples. And then during the training phase, you extract the general rules that later on allows you in the testing phase to start with new sequence or structure, and then achieve a sort of annotation that you call, and we call, the prediction. How many methods are around? Well, so many. Neural network, support vector machine, hidden Markov models, conditional random fields, random forest. After all, even deep learning, but deep learning is a variance of neural networks, I would say an extension of neural networks, in which even the features are somehow extracted from the method. Well, in any case, here we are. What did we do in Bologna? Well, starting 2001 and 2, and I should mention, as I will immediately show to you, a collaboration also with Alfonso Valencia and in this group, and particularly Florenzo Pathos, those days. We started with ISPRED 1 in 2001, so roughly 20 years ago, and was completely based on artificial neural networks, structured derived features, and mainly taking as input feature the sequence profile, down to what we released recently, that is called ISPRED 4. It is practically a method that is again structure-based, but it changed a little bit the method because it goes through support vector machine and grammatical restraint in 10 random fields. So practically through the years, what changed? Well, even somehow the different methods that we implemented, but specifically even the richness in the input, since we were able to implement training set increased through the years, we were able to implement many more features. And we have also a predictor in preparation that is based on sequence. Okay, so still we have a very low accuracy. We are not happy, but this is the situation even in for the competitors. So what did we do? And I remember this paper, you know, that belongs to the history of our collaboration with Florencio Passos and Alfonso Valencia. We applied here ISPRED, one of the first versions of ISPRED, in order to set a basic notion that you may use predictors, they are very good, provided that they can be compared with what experiment tells you. And so in this paper, we predicted an experimentally validated complex, and we were able indeed, and these are all the predictions, and we were able indeed to focus on whatever had been experimentally validated. And later on, we were happy because, you know, having an experimentally validated prediction is what we like the most in this field. So features in ISPRED 4 are obviously relative to the solvent accessibility, first of all, because surface rate residues are determined when the solvent accessibility is higher than 20%. And we use 46 descriptors to encode the surface residues. So 46, I don't have really the time to go through all the details, to roll through all the details. Then if somebody is telling me how much time I have left, perhaps I can realize what I will focus. Hello? Can you tell me how much time I have left?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, okay, maximum, thanks. And the scripts also are derived from sequence, and they are relative to sequence profile, residue conservation, physicochemical properties, solvent exposure, depth and protrusion, so geometrical indexes, etc. So the take-home message is that after all, through the years, we learned how to implement so many features in relation to all the residues that are in a contact patch. A strategy is obviously to focus on a residue and to have a simplified representation of the residue environment in the space, and so later on to reduce practically for each exposed residue the residue and its first neighbors to a sort of flat sequence. And each residue in the sequence later on can be represented as a vector, and the vector contains all the different properties. This is more or less the strategy. So as I said, you start from the structure, you derive the protein sequence representation in terms of only those residues that are exposed. And then you start, you know, with a classificator. So with this, for example, a support vector machine, in order to label which residue is in the interaction or is not at the interaction. And then you have a filter that is, for example, in this case, a conditional random field filter that allows you to predict whatever can is or is not at the interaction. Again, a little bit more detail. You start with an input, and the support vector machine is labeling practically whatever is interacting or not interacting. And whatever comes out of the support vector machine is filtered by a sort of very generalized HMM, that is called grammatical restraint hidden conditional random field, in which the transition and emission probabilities are a rather complex function of the input. That's it. So I don't know if you need more. Obviously, if you are fond of more details, you may always refer to the papers that are behind our work. So again, we use the specific training data set, and this time, Castrense e Savoiardo, who is the main developer of the tool, wanted to focus mainly on those complexes that are present also as monomers in the PDB. And this obviously constrained the number of proteins that were used for training and testing the set. And for testing, we used practically what Capri the experiment called CAPRI that is around in order to understand all the methods that are good in predicting the interaction and the docking experiments are suggesting. So we ended up possibly with the usual evaluation procedure and then scoring indexes, remember specificity and sensitivity, and eventually the harmonic mean, but and the, obviously the most important, that is the Matthew correlation coefficient. We immediately turned to this CAPRI blind data set in order to find out which were the most used complexes also in this competition. So critical assessment of predicted interaction. So the actual data set on which ISPRED4 was implemented and trained is not that large. It's very much selected, okay? And so here, obviously, the performance comparison of ISPRED with other state-of-the-art predictors that are around, and you see the precision of our method, so to say the specificity of our method, as well as the recall, more than the recall, the harmonic mean F1 is, well compares with whatever is around, including the Matthew correlation coefficient that is higher than what is around. The performance on the so-called CAPRI blind dataset obviously is lower in terms of the values of the scoring indices, but still is competing with respect to other experiments. Again, our method is very stable, so the average MCC, it's comparable no matter if the blinding, if the complexes in the blinding test sets were difficult or easier according to the classification of CAPRI. So the higher the root mean square deviation, the more difficult it is to predict exactly what's going on in terms of interacting surfaces. But again, the predictor is stable. And finally, the website here, ISPRED4 website, is available to everybody and gives you the possibility of, retrieving whatever is predicted with a good reliability according to the behavior of the predictor. But what I want to, in the last minutes, what I want to show you is a little bit what I mean when I'm saying that ISPRED4 is predicting. So what I mean is very simple because, for example, if you focus on in one of the complexes that are around in the PDB, obviously they were not used for training and testing the predictor, what's going on here is that you have this very huge complex that contains ligands and receptor, and each ligand has at least two interfaces with the receptors, the same receptor, so the chains are the same, one for the ligand, one for the receptor, but the situation is rather complicated as you see. So for example here, you have, if you're focused on the ligand, you have two interfaces with two chain of receptor. You have 79 solvent accessible residues. You have some 43 interaction sites. And then here you have the performance of ISPRED4. So high precision. So 34 out of 43 are already predicted in terms of interactions of the residues that are exposed at the interfaces. You have a low rate of false negatives, and then you have false positives. And here, I'm going back to the concept of multidimensionality. What is the false positives in this field? Huh. You may say, okay, they are false positives because they are not declared or they are not found at the interaction in the PDB structure. But if you are going back to the so-called virtual space of interaction, immediately you recognize that in principle, you may have so many different interactors that eventually even the false positives may hide new interactions. And indeed, this is, or maybe considered, a sort of, you know, new frontier to explore. That indeed, whatever is false positives can be reconciled with whatever is multidimensional in this field. Having said this, I'll show you immediately a new application that we are now curating. That is an application that is done in collaboration with the Elixir 3 dimensional bioinfo community, in which the applications, you know, the task was, can you recognize whatever is a functional interface from whatever is not a functional interface? So Dambrack and Levi provided sort of very much curated set of functional complexes. And what we did recently was to use ESPRET4 in order to score function, to separate function from non-functional complexes. And again, the whole community that is working with us was rather surprised that indeed ESPRET4 was sort of being, you know, it's not perfect, but was able to discriminate whatever is functional from whatever is not functional in terms of the interfaces. Then it's quite obvious that since we are also annotating disease-related variants in protein, that immediately one application can be the searching of protein interaction sites that are involved in disease-related variation. And the ingredient for doing such an experiment are obviously the human protein 3D database. For example, UNSAVAR is a reference database where you can find all the possible variations that are disease related, and then ESPRET4. And what you do then is a sort of, you map all the disease related variation into the PDB proteins, and then you discriminate between solvent exposed and varied. And what you want later on to do is to end up with this type of interesting results, perhaps in terms of the causes of the disease, that in principle, at least 43% or 40%, nowadays we have a little bit an higher statistics, but we are in the range of 40 to 50% of whatever is disease related is also in interaction with other proteins. So this is interesting also for understanding the possible mechanism of a disease. And finally, this testing hypothesis that I really care. Why? Because, you know, it's practically is a new frontier for us who are bioinformatician, because the testing hypothesis is the following. So application number three, so we are at the end of the story. Are proteins involved in phase transitions endowed with intrinsically disordered regions? So you remember, I started claiming or giving you a very short and small description of whatever is the protein phase separation nowadays. And so it's called also phase transition of proteins. And there is a tendency of associating this particular aspect of proteins with what are called intrinsically disordered regions. I like better the word flexible region in a protein. Okay, so what do you need to test this hypothesis? Again, a database of detected protein-protein interactions, for example, INTEPT and eventually BioGrid, these databases, a database of, sorry for the misspelling here, a database of protein disorder and mobility annotations, such as MobiDB, held by, run by Silvio Tosato at the University of Padova, for example, a set of proteins known to form a membrane-less organelle, this is more difficult to find out, and then our ESPRET, that, you know, structure or sequence-based. We have a sequence-based version that has not been released, but it's done. So the membraneless organelle that we focused on is the Cajal body that was recognized in the 19th century, at the beginning of the 19th centuries, but nowadays we have more information on all the proteins that are in the Cajal bodies. And so they are annotated. And so we derive these 25 proteins that are present in UniProt with the annotation Cajal body cellular component. Most of the proteins have only a sequence. So we use the sequence-based spread. And what did we predict? We predict for each protein the number of interaction sites starting from the sequence. We derive the number of flexible sites from MobiDB, and then we found the intersection between predicted sites and flexible sites. And then we also download all the interaction that these proteins have in the Intact or BioGrid database. As you may understand from this correlation, what's going on? If you are now correlating the number of interactors of each of these proteins in Intact and in BioGrid with the number of predicted residues in interaction, you have 0.4 or 0.41 as a correlation value. Flexible sites, it's rather low, you may see from here, if you compare this number. But the correlation increases if we consider the interaction between whatever is flexible and whatever is interacting. And obviously you may derive immediately some conclusion. First of all, that all these proteins have a large number of interactors than the average number of interactions that human protein have in Intact and BioGrid. So interesting. So the human protein on average has 13 or 18 interactions depending on the database. But when you are considering the proteins that do belong to this membraneless organelle, the average number of interactors increases dramatically. Okay. The number of interactions per protein moderately correlates with the number of residues of flexible sites and increases if we consider the correlation with whatever spread is predicting as being at the interaction in the interaction patches. But correlation reaches a satisfactory value when the number of residues that can be annotated both as PPI and flexible sites is considered. So conclusion, suggestion, better than conclusion because we did only one experiment with the causal body so far. The inherent flexibility of the residues make it possible to adjust the interaction surface protein to multiple patterns. And here we are again going multidimensional from one single observation, having derived much of our knowledge from the PDB, so from what I call the golden standard of our knowledge, you are now inferring whatever is going on in the space of the protein-protein interaction. So we have different predictors in Bologna, fantastic. We have the Bologna function annotation resource, and so all our predictor predicting whatsoever in terms of different features given a sequence are organized in a sort of flow in order to go from annotation, functional annotation, up to protein-protein interaction in the space of interactomics. And then all these predictors, or many, I would say many of these predictors, are also compliant with the Elixir, European Elixir rules, and they are indeed accepted in this BioTools registry. Then thanksgiving to Piero Fariselli, that is one of the major responsible co-founder of the biocomputing group in Bologna, and is now a full professor at the University of Turin. Then Pierluigi Martelli, who is still suffering of my presence in Bologna. He's an associate professor, we hope, in the position of becoming a full professor very soon, and we will let you know. So then Pierluigi Martelli will be the group leader of the biocomputing group, and I will be declassed to be the senior member of the biocomputing group. And then we have Cassenzi Savoiardo, who is going to become a senior researcher. And this very young lady who just got the position of young researcher, that is Giulia Babbi, that is in charge of the disease, whatever is disease related, is compliant with Giulia Babbi. As was mentioned, we are running a Bologna Master Bioinformatics second cycle degree since 2007, and we also have this tradition of the Bologna Winter Schools. And this year, since we will have, the next year, the 2021, if we were still under this situation, Alfonso can join us and give a lecture in staying in remote. And so we will count on this because we are thinking to organize the winter school in a remote mode. And that's it. Thank you for your attention. I hope that you didn't fall asleep like this guy here. And it's been a pleasure to be invited to give such a seminar in this situation. So thank you again. Hello? Thank Are you there? Time. Did you fall asleep?
All the time.
Thank you so much.
Okay, so now I have stopped. You are sharing the screen. I don't want to share the screen anymore. I will not be able.
I think we have 5 minutes, something like that, for questions.
Yeah, but I wanted to become alive again.
I don't.
Right. So, any questions?
Hi, here. Okay. Here we are.
I have a question.
So, hello.
Hello. Thank you so much for the really nice presentation. My question is about the phase separation and the predictions about this. So I was wondering, like, given the highly dynamic and reversible nature of the phase separation process, what is the role of transient interaction in this kind of predictions? So basically, is it possible to distinguish between strong interactions and weak interactions that may be important?
This is a very good question because I'm always thinking about it. Problem is that we focused on the causal body. The causal body is there, sometimes it's very stable, it's been recognized spectroscopically, I don't know, has been followed. I don't think this is highly dynamic. So other, there are data, very, very, very few data on other assemblies that eventually have been found, but they are not so well documented in the database, so I couldn't possibly come here and show this example to you. I agree with you. There is a lot that we can do about predicting which possible complexes, even transiently, can be organized in such a way that can be called membraneless. For example, one idea would be, very naive idea that I have, although my collaborators are always saying, it's a naive idea. To consider, for example, the CAT pathways. Try to collect the proteins in the CAT pathway and see, because many of the CAT pathways protein, they don't have structure, and see if there is a possibility later on that these proteins can be recognized as transient, but possibly because they are endowed with interactions or flexible regions or the combination of both. Fantastic, but then you need also to go experimentally and prove it, because otherwise can be also, everything can be done theoretically, but then later on, if you want to get credit out of it, you should also at least try to produce a sort of experiment proving it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. Hello?
Hi, Rita. This is Patrick.
Hello. Ciao, how are you?
Very good. So very interesting talk. Thank you very much. Easy question. So I didn't get, so for the Cajal body stuff, so do you require the two proteins to or the two interfaces to be in flexible regions or only one of them?
This is very, it's not a very easy question. It's not a very easy question. And in principle, we didn't make any distinction, although we know that there are features that can tell you whether the complex is transient or stable. We are simply considering one single monomer and the possibility that this single monomer is interacting with something else.
Okay, then my question is what fraction?
Yeah, so it's different from your method or the template-based method.
Hmm? No, absolutely. So the okay, question good. Is whether you find that most of these interactions are a kind of a domain interacting with a flexible peptide or are between two flexible interfaces?
This I don't know. I cannot tell you.
Okay.
Hmm? Because we never thought of investigating the partner. So we are sort of doing it. But the idea is that in principle, whatever is flexibility comes out of MobiDB. So it's been annotated in different ways, etc. So we are not predicting flexibility. And whatever is at the interaction, when it's also endowed with flexibility, nicely correlates with the number of interactors in the databases. But we don't know if it's a physical interaction or simply an interaction that is produced in the virtual space of Interact and BioGrid, for example.
Okay.
Thank you. So a lot of other things needs to be done. Thank you for the question. No?
Any other questions for Rita? So I think I have a question myself, but it's very similar probably to what you were already discussing with Patrick. So because you presented this in the attempt of identifying protein-protein interface and there is no distinction or easy distinction in features when it comes to comparing protein-protein interface to protein surface. And so I was wondering whether you found...
May I interrupt you? It's a yes. Protein surface at the interaction. Okay, fantastic. Sorry.
Yes. So it seems it's rather complex to identify those features that might be helpful in distinguishing. So, I mean, that's why we had to go to machine learning and probably a complex combination of the features can help in the task of predicting protein-protein interface. But the question now is, you found this enrichment of flexibility at the interface of these causal bodies. And I was wondering if there was already any similar behavior in general in the protein interactome. Is it true that flexible sites or proteins that are flexible have more interactors?
As I showed you, in principle, our strategy, and we did already a publication years back in the years, our strategy is reconcile what we call false negatives with the idea that eventually they are also interaction sites for other possible imputative predictors that are in the interactomic space but are not documented at the level of the PDB. I don't know if I was enough clear, because this is a rather naive concept that it's been already debated in the literature. Actually, the idea came to Pierre Baldi when we were claiming that we had too many false negatives. And the idea was indeed, are you sure that they are false negatives? Because if you think in terms of an interactomic space, perhaps you have many more sites of interaction when you are considering a protein. So I didn't go recently through all these items. Sure that one can go and one can have a larger view of my conclusion in terms of the causal body protein. So you may do obviously a much larger analysis to reconcile the idea of having protein-protein interaction sites that are flexible. So I can answer this question right now in a large scale because I didn't do the analysis myself. But what I can offer to you is the fact that in principle, when you are increasing or considering the false negatives as putative interaction sites, you may find a correlation of these false negatives with the number of proteins and the interaction in the virtual space of the interactomics. But this is a paper that we had out years back in the year, so we didn't have all this plethora of information that we have nowadays. Perhaps the flexible proteins were not even invented, so if I remember correctly, but this can be done, obviously.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question.
Let me ask this in a different way. Let me see if I can phrase it. We know that in CASP, 2 years ago, there was a lot of progress in predicting protein structure, these are monomers. Would not be surprising if there is even more progress this year, in a few weeks. Imagine that there is a lot of progress. We don't know yet, but imagine that there is a lot of progress and predicting protein monomers becomes very easy. There is also a number of complexes in CASP. In principle, there will be no difference between predicting monomers and predicting obligatory multimers. So, you know, in this futuristic view, in a few weeks, maybe the problem of predicting obligatory multimers is solved, and the predicting monomers is solved too. Will this be different for non-obligatory complexes? Is there an intrinsic difference between, for a machine learning view, of predicting obligatory and not obligatory complexes, or is there an intrinsic biophysical difference? You are talking about the flexibility of the regions and the differences between interfaces and not interfaces.
Well, this is it's a very interesting topic. What I may say immediately is the following. Whatever is not obligatory, is it functional or not? So I have this question in mind. Why? Because recently working with the community, the 3D community, indeed, there was the point, but we just started in trying to understand what is a functional interface in opposition to whatever is an interface, but is not a functional interface. So perhaps whatever is functional, is it obligatory? Now I'm thinking about it. So indeed, this is the case, you should ask the question to Drambach and Levine, who were able to discriminate between functional dimers, for example, because we are now at the dimer level for doing this analysis, and whatever is not functional. And I think that they rely mainly on the annotation of whatever has been deposited in the database or whatever is known in terms of functionality. But perhaps you are right, perhaps there is a difference. So if I will be able to get an experimentally determined database of non-obligatory versus obligatory complexes, perhaps we can solve the problem. As Dr. Lepore was pointing out, perhaps we can find out that indeed, whatever is flexible is also at the interaction. Whatever is not flexible, maybe is not at the interaction of whatever you consider a flexible lateral side chain. So my conclusion, I mean, is very short, and particular experiment with the casual body proteins, although it has been done with a predictor that even I can confess that is not at the top scoring, but scoring as other predictors that are based on sequence. So from there, we were able to say, okay, fantastic. If we combine the two properties, and we never really considered introducing also the feature flexibility in our predictor, whenever you combine the two properties, you are ending up with a good correlation with all the number of interactomes of whatever proteins you have in a database of interactomics. You have one problem here, that is that sooner or later, every once in a while, as we know, data are sort of specifically this higher level of interaction, they are changing. So whatever release of the human interactomic consider, 1 year, you have to change the next year. So perhaps these numbers are sort of being flexible. But, you know, interaction, correlation can be always done. So my idea, my answer at this point, specific point, is that perhaps I can suggest to add the 47 feature as flexibility, in terms of flexibility, and then perhaps go back and try to not to consider later on, you know, the different scoring indices computed on the PDB structure, but to go around and to explore the space of interactomics. I don't know if I answered or not, but perhaps this is a good idea. But, we have to find out. So whenever we will have this data out of CAFA, perhaps we can try to, since I am sure that the CAFA data are public, later on they are released, and eventually they can be screened with a tool in which among the different features, flexibility is considered. But then I have a problem. The database MobiDB is a sort of consensus method that takes into consideration many different predictors of whatever is called disorder or flexibility. So I use the database vision, taking the consensus method. So I don't know. Okay, but there is still sort of problems in predicting the flexibility of a given residue. It's not that is everything is so well curated. So I don't know if you agree with my possibility, my view, my possible solution. I don't have the solution at the moment. But you know, if we have the data, we may screen for these further possibility. For sure, the liquid phase separation method, perhaps if it is going to be applied experimentally, will give us new understanding, new vision, new possibilities to explore. There is another story around that is the single cell sequencing. Do you think that it will change our vision of proteomics? First of all, of genomics and then proteomics, perhaps. I don't know. I don't know. I heard data. I heard results, you know, pointing out that when you are screening a tumor cell, the situation is totally different if you are using the normal sequencing routine and you compare with the cell sequencing. But I don't know. I mean, we will see.
We shall see.
Yeah. We have new people in the field. We are hiring new people, and so they will go on in doing research, I hope.
Alba, there are more questions?
I think Rock had a question. Is still there, Rock?
Yeah, hi. Hi, Rita. Thanks for your talk. So I'm quite new in the structural bioinformatics, but I have maybe a rather simple question. But so what are the features that you take into account in order to distinguish between functional and non-functional interacting sites?
As I said, ask Dumbrank and Levi. You find in my slides, by the way, slides have been recorded as well, or should I send you at least the PDF of the slides if you need them? Do you have an answer for me?
Yes, if you can please send either PDF, what's easier for you, it would be great.
Okay, I can release the slides. Problem is,
I think the slides were checked this, but in case I will be.
Sorry, I didn't get it. Alba, or so, who else was talking? Okay, in case you need the slides, the PDF, I can give you the PDF, no problem. As long as you keep it reserved for a while. But I mean, whatever, I've been responsible, with the exception of this experiment in which ESPRED was capable of distinguishing with two scoring functions between functional from non-functional interfaces. But again, the data set was prepared by Dombrank and Levi and released to us by them. So I don't know the detail, although I should, sorry, but they were sort of too complicated for me to understand on the edge, and they didn't publish so far the details of their, of their selection. So these data are somehow reserved in this sense, and they will be presented in a meeting that will be run at the end of November by the community. And it's this 3D bioinformatics community that will have the meeting depending on the three activities that are going on in this community. And we belong to the second activity, that is indeed protein-protein interaction or whatsoever, or something similar that is led by Susan, by Professor Vodak and Susan Vodak. So I don't know too many details in relation to what they do. Perhaps if you are going to their websites, there are some hints on this, but I cannot be concise enough in order to understand. I think that what they did, they focus mainly on the annotation and then try to understand if they have different organization of the assembly in the database, which was the one reflecting the annotation. But this is very general, so. Obviously, when you are saying a functional annotation interface is an annotation that contains at least a small peptide, any molecule or whatsoever, And then it is easy to find the functional complex dimer or hetero complex in the PDB. But that was not the case because they were dealing with homodimers. So they were trying to differentiate functional homodimers from non-functional interacting homodimers. And that is a little bit more difficult to achieve. But in any case, ESPRED was capable of labeling these residues in such a way that we could discriminate functional interfaces from non-functional ones. It's not that we are going to publish this data. We will publish in a collective paper. I don't know how it works at the moment.
Thanks.
Thank you for the question. If you need more details, either you write me or I send you the presentation. But I will send the presentation to whom?
I will get in touch. I will get in touch with you if anybody asks for the presentation.
Okay, good.
Yeah. So Is there any further questions for Rita? I think we are running late for your meeting, I think.
With Alfonso?
Yes, you have.
But I have to change the chamber, the room, sorry.
Yes. So okay. I think we can.
And then I have a late meeting with Alba as well?
Yes, with okay. me, yes.
Fantastic.
All right.
Okay, so, thank you to everybody. It was a pleasure. My suggestion, my pray is stay safe. Okay?
Thanks, Rita.
Thank you, Rita.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks, bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.